What's up, duelists? Tomorrow is RBET Rulers, the end of the year invitational. If you've qualified for this event and you have the invite and you are not already in the really big Yu-Gi-Oh! Discord ready to sign up for this event, make sure you join in the description below. I don't know if I think pretty much everyone has the role, everyone is ready to go, but just in case you haven't seen that already, go ahead and join the Really Big Yu-Gi-Oh! Discord in the description below. And if you want to play in these 8-man style tournaments in the future, go ahead and join that Discord as well, because this is where we host these 8-man style tournaments, what I'm about to show you guys. Anyway, today's video was actually going to be a members-only video, because I didn't want to upload a video today. I wanted to do like kind of a RBET tailgate stream, which I am still doing. So in a few hours, if you're not doing anything on Friday night, you want to tune into the RBET tailgate stream, stop by, come say hi, tell me your opinions, what you think is going to win the tournament, etc., etc. Also, the reason it's not going to be a members-only video is because these matches were so good. These were some of the best matches of Yu-Gi-Oh! I've ever played. They were incredibly exciting. All three really good players, all three really close games, and while sometimes I do make sure the members get that exclusive juiciness, which is another reason to become a member, join the membership. Every week you get an exclusive video. I just had to share these games with you guys. Like, they're really, really sick. Anyway, I was playing an 8-man with Quickdraw. Right now, this is the deck I've been having the most fun playing with. I think Quickdraw is actually really underrated by a lot of people. When we were reflecting on the RBET topping deck list recently, this deck had a lot more results than I remembered it having, which is good. It's good that this deck is still around. I think it's a fun deck. It's an exciting deck. This list, I'm not really sold on it, but so far, what I do like is I've liked playing triple Debris Dragon. I've really liked the Treeborn Frog. I've loved the Enemy Controller and Compulsory Tech. And then I've also just been a really big fan of triple Caius. I think this card is too powerful not to play three of. There are some issues with playing triple Caius and triple Avarice. It can lead to a lot of really slow and clunky starting hands, and I have been siding out one Caius going second a lot of the time, just because drawing too many tribute monsters going second can be really clunky. But that being said, I've been really, really happy with them. The Thestalos, this is a tech that Feng Shui played in his top 8 list at the beginning of the year. I'm not sure if they're good or bad. I don't know. Sometimes they're really nice, sometimes they're a little bit clunky. It's hard for me to really tell. I do side them out a lot. So going second, especially, I do side out both of them a lot. But I think the card is pretty solid. I think it's a great tech for this archetype of deck, for this archetype. And another card, Charge of the Light Brigade. I've been siding this card out a lot. It's pretty good, but it just searches Ryko, and sometimes, like in the mid to late game, it's not really the best top deck. I think if you are playing triple Debris as well as Treeborn Frog, you do kind of need to play Charge of the Light Brigade, because it just makes sure you can get your tribute fodder, you can hit your dandelions for your five monarchs, etc. If you're not playing as many monarchs, like let's say you're only playing two Caius and no Thestalos, I don't think you need to play Charge, and I honestly don't know if you really should play Charge. It depends on your configuration of your list. The sideboard, the cards I've been really happy with. Kaiku the Ghost Destroyer has been amazing. Triple Breaker has been amazing. Thunder King, kind of on the fence about. Lightning Vortex, I wasn't going to leak this tech, but here it is. I was playing Lightning Vortex, and honestly, it's been underperforming. I think I might switch it up with something a little bit more more technically proficient. Yes, it is a powerful effect, but we already have a lot of sweepers in this deck. We have Torrential Mirror Force, and then of course we have Triple Debris for the Black Rose Nuke. I'm not really sold on Lightning Vortex, but it might switch. It might switch to like a second Crow or something like that. I'm not really sure. But I've been really happy with the rest of the sideboard, especially the Breakers. They've been really good. Normally, like I said, when I side out the Thestalos, I do bring in the Vanity's Fiend in the matchups where it matters. That'll come up today. The extra deck has felt perfect. I have needed both Iron Chains and both Ancient Fairies. So yes, I do think that it is mandatory to play two of each. It does come up a lot, especially when you're on only two Avarice, that you want the second Iron Chain or the second Ancient Fairy Dragon. So I think those are definitely much more mandatory than like Road Warrior or Trident if you're playing Call, or like the third Chimera Tech or something like that. All right, let's get into matches. Let's get into matches. Let's see. Round one was up against. That's not round one. That's not round one. A little bit of spoilers. All right, round one was up against Vatos. Shout out Vatos. I met him at Nationals at Raleigh. Really nice guy. Incredibly nice guy. So pretty exciting to play against him. I do win the Rock, Paper, Scissors. Rare W for your boy. I start off with Loam Fire. This card is so incredibly broken, and I also love the new collector's rare ones. They look amazing. So I go into Titanial, and I actually do set my Heavy Storm here. Usually, I don't like setting Heavy Storm in these types of hands because there's really no difference in me setting it and not setting it. But because I have Titanial, I can stop him from like Space Typhooning my lone back row, something like that. Or I can stop him from like Icarus attacking it or whatever. I can stop him from like, I guess basically what I'm saying is the only thing that punishes me is my opponent's own Heavy Storm. And I'm actually pretty okay with my Heavy Storm trading with his because as I draw more back row, I'm going to want to set them immediately. So if he has his own Heavy Storm and trades it with mine, that's cool. And then everything else doesn't really punish me. It can't get popped by Ryko because I have Titanial. Next turn, I can flip Heavy Storm. I could like normal debris, bring out Lone Fire. And then another reason why I kind of like setting Heavy Storm here is because the only way he's going to out Titanial in like an average deck is like Mirror Force or Torrential. And those are cards he has to commit in order to prevent this card from defeating him in three turns. This is very real pressure. So I think setting the Heavy Storm here is a good bait. It's a good sort of, it's a safe pro heavy, basically, I would say, behind Titanial. He's special Cyber Dragon, he goes for Smashing Ground, so he does have a main deck out here to the Titanial, which is pretty good, and he's able to hit us for 21, which is also pretty good. So he has the reversal, which is nice. He sets his one back row and passes a turn. I decide here that I want to get even more greedy. At this point, he can't Heavy Storm my Heavy Storm without popping his own back row. So I feel like there's a couple of options, right? I could flip Heavy Storm, I could summon Debris, I can make Black Rose, I could run over the Cyber Dragon, and then I could Pot of Avarice in case things go south, right? I could do that. Or I could set Ryko with intent to pop either his back row or his monster or something like that and try to stabilize the position and just get three cards closer to activating Avarice that way. I think the safest play is to set the Ryko because right now I don't know what he's playing. Smashing Ground is a card that could be in theoretically any deck. Cyber Dragon is a card that could be in theoretically any deck. It could be anything from Machina to this could be a Lightsworn deck because I've seen Lightsworn decks play Cyber Dragon main, times two topped with it main. This could be a... what is another deck to play Smashing Ground? This could be Glads. This could be a whole bunch of things. So basically what I want to do is I just want to set Ryko because I think it's a little bit safer than going for the Debris Dragon because I don't know if he plays Honest. This could be Hero Beat even, and Hero Beat does play Honest. So I feel like just setting the Ryko is the safest. Plus, it gets me an extra turn towards being able to use my Heavy Storm for max value. He attacks the Ryko. Ryko's going to pop the Cyber Dragon. He's going to lose the Cyber Dragon, and we are going to hit Dandelion. So absolutely rewarded for waiting there, basically. We get our Dandy tokens. He summons a monster confirming what he is playing. He's playing Machina Gadgets because he's got the yellow gadget. Well, we don't know he's playing Machina Gadgets, but if you're playing Gadgets and Cyber Dragon, you're probably playing Machina Gadgets. Either that or you're playing like some D-Fissure Gadgets, but he would have set more back row if he was playing D-Fissure Gadgets. So yeah, he searches a gadget, passes. We draw a Torrential Tribute, I think is what we drew. Yeah. So our hand's really good now. Our hand's really, really good. I go ahead and Avarice back all my cards. Except Dandelion, of course. I've got a couple of different plays here I can make. I draw into two more plays, Space Typhoon and Lone Fire Blossom. And now I'm like getting maximum greed. I'm actually going to Typhoon his lone back row here. And I'm going to get my Titanial out of my deck. So second Titanial sighting. Sacrifice the token, use the other Lone Fire, sacrifice that for Titanial. And I'm getting a little bit greedy leaving this Lone Fire in attack position. If he does have like some sort of gear frame limiter removal thing, I can lose here. Like, I can straight up lose here from this position if he has gear frame plus limiter removal. But I'm just saying, fuck it, you don't have it. You know what I mean? I'm just gonna get greedy, get my 500 damage, apply as much pressure as possible so that potentially Kaius plus Titanial can be lethal at some point in the game. It's not looking like that's gonna be the case anytime soon, but it's possible I should have also just left a token in defense position instead of having this Lone Fire here and saved. Like, I'm trading 500 for more than 500 here. But I figured that getting in the damage is more likely to benefit me because I have cards like Black Rose that can switch things to attack to get extra damage. I have Kaius as a way to force damage. I have Torrential into a reversal sort of situation. So I have a lot of ways to try and find damage. So I think getting the extra 500 is going to be more valuable than him hitting me for an extra 500. And the chances I lose here are pretty slim. I don't set the Torrential because I don't want to play into his Heavy Storm. He only set one last turn. So either he has no further back row or he has more background. He was scared to play around heavy storm. Another reason to go for the Typhoon is to represent that we maybe don't have heavy storm. He pitches and summons the Fortress. He attacks over the Lone Fire. He attacks over the defense position Lone Fire and then passes the turn after setting it back row. We draw Raikou here, which is not the best draw because we have a bunch of like normal summon situations, but it's actually not too bad of a situation because we did wait on that heavy storm. Waiting on the heavy storm also ensures that if he set multiple here on the following turn, I would be able to clear multiple and then go for my follow-up Debris Dragon. Because we milled that Dandelion, we're so far ahead here. I can summon Debris Dragon, summon Dandelion, Synchro into Ancient Fairy Dragon, attack over the Green Gadget, and then attack over the Machina Fortress. He's done a great job playing around Heavy Storm this whole game, despite not knowing that it could potentially be set there. We negate by sacrificing a token, and here we do set the Torrential because there's really no reason not to. If he goes for like a big setup with like double fortress or some shit like that, I might want to Torrential that. Who knows? If he spends all his resources, I might want to Torrential that and just leave him with nothing. So there's really no reason not to set it. And if he goes for Heavy Storm, that's one of his three cards gone. So I'm pretty happy about that too. He goes Red Gadget, search Yellow Gadget. He attacks the token after setting two back row. So did a great job playing around Heavy Storm. Didn't overcommit into it and passes a turn. We draw Thestalos. And here I make what I think is the correct play. So if you look at his back row, it can't be Torrential and it's unlikely to be Bottomless. So Ancient Fairy Dragon has this effect. This is the errated text, but it says during your main phase, you can special summon one level 4 or lower monster from your hand. You cannot conduct your battle phase during the turn you activate this effect. This effect is still the same on the pre-errated text. So if I activate Ancient Fairy Dragon here and special summon Sangin, I'm not going to play into Torrential because he doesn't have it. I also don't really want to attack this turn because I don't want to play into Mirror Force, really. I don't want to lose my Titanial. So I'm going to try to just set up my board a little bit better and like try to get some of these normal summons out of my hand and secure my position a little bit better before I go for like a major push. Because if I push into Mirror Force here, there's a chance I just get randomly reversaled by Gadget Beatdown because I have a bunch of normal summons that can't like be played. Basically, like, let's say I swing into Mirror Force here with both my monsters. All of a sudden, he has another summon of a gadget. I have to set a Raikou main phase 2. He attacks the gadget, the Raikou, maybe the Raikou hits something, but I just have the Sangin and this Kaius. I'm getting beat down by multiple gadgets, you know? Either that or I'm forced to Raikou pop a gadget, which is terrible, just to keep my life total high. So I think the best way to go about this is to convert these normal summons into real cards. Use the Ancient Fairy Dragon special summon the Sangin, sacrifice it for Thestalos. Thestalos discarding his last monster. So this is a way to attack his resources while also speed up my own resources. I'm going to turn this Sangin into a Debris Dragon. So next turn, I have potential for Nuke in case things go south. I can't conduct my battle phase this turn, but that's totally fine. I'm going to switch my Ancient Fairy to defense and pass the turn. Next turn, I'm going to swing two of my monsters into back row. If things go poorly, then I can Debris Dragon, make another Ancient Fairy main phase 2, and have two more tokens for my Titanial. So yeah, he goes Smashing Ground. That does clear the Ancient Fairy, but thankfully it leaves us with our Titanial. He switches the Red Gadget, passes back. We draw Bottomless. Not the best card in this matchup, but it is good at hitting Machina Fortress, so you're kind of forced to leave it in some capacity. I summon Debris Dragon. This is where the second Ancient Fairy comes up. I summon Ancient Fairy and attack. I don't really want to spend my Black Rose quite yet. I could have summoned Black Rose here to try and force lethal by by switching his guy to attack, but I didn't want to spend my Black Rose. I feel like just going for the second Ancient Fairy is pretty safe. This also protects me against like top deck Smashing Ground type shit if he has Mirror Force. So I'm gonna go ahead. Well, it doesn't protect me because if he has Mirror Force, he's just gonna Mirror Force both monsters here, but we'll see. I switched the Titanial to defense. I'm not sure if it's better to go for Black Rose here or not. It might have been better to go for Black Rose here. I'm not really sure. Anyway, we attack over the gadget, we attack for 24. He takes the 24. Yeah, I probably should have gone for Black Rose just because it was forcing. It doesn't really matter because our position is so good. We're up like a solid 5 cards and we have Titanial in play with 2 tokens. So it's pretty much impossible for him to win from this point, and he concedes. So the next game, I do side in. Let me look at the deck again. I do side in the Cyber Dragons, and I side in the Breakers, and I side in the Pulling the Rugs, and I side in the Thunder King and the Dust Tornado. So I sided really aggressively. The cards I sided out Charge, I sided out some number of Thestalos, I sided out one Quick Draw because I wasn't sure if he was going to be on Royal Oppression or like Rivalry or some shit post-board. I sided out, I kept all my Debris Dragon, which I think in hindsight was a mistake. I also kept in my Treeborn Frog, which might have been a mistake as well. I kept in all of my monsters that I want to set, like Sangin, Dandelion, that sort of thing, which, you know, this deck can side knock. I'm not sure if he was or not, but it can side knock, so who knows. My opening hand is not great, though. I sided out one of my bottoms. That's what I remember. Yeah, I sided out one bottomless as well to bring in Pulling the Rugs. These are more potent summon stops versus the deck. They stop Gear Frame. They stop the gadgets. You really only want bottomless as a way to deal with Machina Fortress, but even Machina Fortress, you can kind of like outclass in a bunch of different ways. It's not really like a card that you're super worried about. You can kind of just wall it out with tokens or just run it over with token Titanial. So you don't really need two bottomless. I left in one, but clearly here it's kind of biting me. Going second, he has the green gadget summon. He adds a red gadget and he doesn't. Oh, he sets two and then passes. I draw Dandelion and I'm like, okay, he could have knock here. If he has knock, it's better for me to go trooper attack. But if he has deprison, it's better for me to not go trooper attack. It's more likely he has deprison than knock. So I'm going to set the Dandelion and pass. I didn't set the bottomless because I thought that I might be going for the debris nuke next turn. So if I go for the debris nuke next turn, I don't want my bottomless set because then I'm going to blow up my own bottomless. That being said, you can get punished for this if your opponent goes for the fortress this turn, which my opponent is electing to do, and he does have the Nobleman. So we chose to play around deprison. Turns out he didn't have deprison instead of playing around knock. And as a result, we kind of get punished. I think it's like a 50-50 or slightly less than a 50-50 because there's more of a chance he has 3 deprison than there is he has 3 knock. But it's possible he sides out deprison in this matchup for knock. So I'm not really sure what the best play there would have been. I think it's kind of just I have a bad hand and there's really not much that can go right. The best way for me to win this game would be for Dandelion to hit the grave and me be able to stick the debris nuke. He attacks me for a shitload of damage, and I'm just like, well, I get punished. I pick up Breaker, which is at the very least decent, because it'll give me some information, but I'm just going to crash the card trooper instead to see if he had the deprison, because I'm dead here. No matter what happens, I'm dead here. If I summon the Breaker, I'm for sure dead, and I give him information that I sided in the Breaker. So I'm going to crash the card trooper, draw a card, I draw into Heavy Storm, I get information off the Heavy Storm, and then I concede the game. So I just don't want to let him know about the breakers. So I basically showed him 3 cards. Unfortunately, he did have the Nobleman, but now we are aware of the Nobleman. So for this game, this upcoming game, I'm going to be a lot less careless about the way I set up my board with like bottomless and stuff like that. So I did side back in the second bottomless just as a way to stop those potent knock turns. I think that it may seem like, oh, bottomless was dead that game, but it was dead because I didn't set it, because I was thinking that I was going to Black Rose Nuke him. If I had set the bottomless there, it would have been a much closer game. I could have gone Breaker, maybe tried to run over something. I don't really know. We wouldn't have taken as much damage. Maybe I could have even set my Raikou. Who knows? You know what I mean? I could have set the Debris Dragon to wall out. Like, there's a bunch of different plays I could have had that game had I set the bottomless. So I figured bottomless is going to be decent at stopping those big knock push turns. So I'm going to side the second one back in. So I did, basically. And this game, instead of like thinking about, oh, I lost that game with bottomless in my hand, I'm thinking more like, if things go south, I'm going to be more proactive about committing to the field and recognizing that if I Black Rose Nuke, even if I lose my bottomless there, I'm still kind of winning. So we do draw Titanial, which is unlucky, but we can go Lone Fire into Dandelion and set Torrential. So that's okay. He does, unfortunately, have Heavy Storm, clearing my Torrential Tribute, Normal Summon, Special Summon Machina Fortress, Pitch Special Dyna, Dyna Attack, Machina Fortress Attack directly. Now, once again, I'm in this situation where he's resolved Fortress, I have Bottomless in hand, and I'm like kicking myself because I've sided in the second one. So I'm like, bruh, but this is just one of those things. You can't super duper prepare for it because Heavy Storm would have cleared both my cards if I had set them. So it's possible I should have thought about holding Torrential and setting bottomless instead, but you don't really know. Maybe he just summons Dyna and then I need to Torrential that instead of pitching Special Fortress and normal summoning Dyna. You know what I mean? Like, maybe there's no way I know, you know what I mean? So I think there's arguments to setting both there, but I think him having Heavy Storm, Dyna plus Fortress, it's kind of hard to predict that situation. He passes a turn. I draw Brain Control, which is a reversal card, but we need to find a Caius. Because as of right now, Brain Control is not getting me out of this situation. Breaker the Magical Warrior is exceptional in these positions. And this is partially why I really like citing this card. Just because it attacks over this bullshit, this motherfucker, everyone is citing it right now. Literally everyone. Blackwings is citing it. Even Frogs is citing it. I've seen decks that lose to it cite it. You know, decks that can't play under it cite it. So everyone is citing this. So the reason I like Breaker is because it comes down, it pops potential D prisons, and then it runs over this motherfucker, and you're just up plus two. And then you also have kind of a buffer on your life total. Here, even though the Breaker isn't popping anything, it's still good because it's just attacking this stupid Dyna that I can't beat. So I attack over the Dyna. I set Bottomless here. So I've got the Bottomless in play now. He doesn't have Heavy Storm. So if I do manage to get rid of this Fortress somehow, he can't bring it back because I've got the Bottomless to deal with it. He goes ahead and smashes my Breaker to try and force damage. He summons a red gadget. He searches yellow gadget. He attacks me for a bunch of damage. 1300 and then 2500. We drop to 17, which is really, really dangerous. Danger zone. And then he sets a new card. This is a card that he must have top decked this for turn. Or it's a bluff. One of those two things. Either he top decked it or it's a bluff. I'm going to go with he top decked it because Smashing Ground is a card you would hold. The gadget is a card you would hold because that's a card that's a card that you couldn't normal summon the same turn you summoned the Dyna. So, like, those are two cards that would be stuck in his hand, whereas the back row is a new card, for sure, because that's a card he would have set no matter what. He passes a turn, and we thankfully top deck Caius. That's, like, this is why I like playing three Caius. I think it's just so important in this deck at having conversions for cards like Brain Control, or cards like Enemy Controller, or Dandy Tokens, or Treeborn. Yeah, this is why I like playing three, and this is why I definitely didn't side out three. I do brain control the fortress. There was some consideration to braining the red gadget, but I figured if his back row is compulsory, it's better to brain control the fortress, because then he'll have to pitch his last gadget to summon it, I guess, and then we could bottomless it then. So I think it was a little bit of a play around compulsory moment. I sack the fortress for Caius, and then I Caius target the red gadget. Now, if he has Bottomless here, we die. Straight up. If he has Solemn here, we die. If he has Torrential here, we die. So there are four cards we lose to. But he doesn't have any of those four cards, so we banish the red gadget, and we pass the turn back. You can't attack here, because then you increase your odds of losing this game into battle traps like Deep Prison, Mirror Force, that sort of stuff. Now, if he has Smashing Ground, we die. There's so many things here that just beat us. He goes ahead and passes the turn back, meaning he drew probably another gadget or some form of like solidarity, something he just didn't want to commit into this Caius. So we pick up Debris Dragon. We have a couple of options. We could Debris Dragon now, but then we play into Torrential. And I was thinking if he had Torrential Tribute last turn, he would have won, but maybe he didn't know that our back row wouldn't have stopped his attack. So maybe he was like, he's waiting for me to overcommit into the Torrential to get a safe moment. This, I think, is a bit of a play error on my part. I definitely should have normaled the Debris Dragon here. And the reason I should have normaled the Debris Dragon is because there's no shot he's not Torrentialing last turn if he has it, basically. I can normal Debris Dragon, I can Synchro into Ancient Fairy, put up two tokens, have a defense position Ancient Fairy, use Caius to swing into the back row and pressure him. I have Bottomless to stop Machine of Fortress. I absolutely should have done that. I don't do that. I just attack for 24, I set the Raikou and pass. So I definitely should have done that. Bit of a mistake on my part, because he absolutely would have Torrentialed me last turn. Anyway, this turn he summons Gearframe, he's able to search his Fortress. He pitches his yellow gadget, which is the last gadget we knew about. But now he does get to proc our Bottomless Trap Hole, which is really nice for us. I'm also happy he didn't search for Machine of Force, because then he would still have that yellow gadget to apply annoying pressure. This is going to banish the Fortress. He's going to pass the turn. I actually like this play from him. If it's Raikou, we're forced to convert it immediately. Otherwise, we can't clear this Fortress or this Gear Frame. And now I'm kind of in a tight spot here. I think the best play from me making that mistake last turn is to flip the Raikou, blow up the back row, clear it in case it's like Torrential, right? And now we have Debris Dragon. In case he had been holding Torrential that long, at this point I'm fairly certain it's just like a bluff. Like, it's not a good card. And we are correct in finding that out. Raikou can mill three, but leaving this guy in play is a liability. What if this is a monster? Which, as you can see, it is. So I have to get rid of this Raikou. And the only way for me to get rid of this Raikou is actually summon the Debris and not use the effect of Debris Dragon. So I summon the debris. I don't use the effect of debris dragon. I synchroned iron chain dragon. I attack over gear frame with the iron chain dragon. I just need to apply pressure and leave two threats in play in case he has guy plus smashing ground. And then I also need to clear the Ryko. And this was the only way to do that. If I double sack for titanial, guy plus smashing ground beats me. If I, basically I'm trying to play around any two card combination by having two threats in play. And then also not leaving a direct alley for him to attack me directly. So yeah, we mill three. I attack directly for 2400. I could have also normal summoned the Thunder King Ryo, but if he just has another gadget there, I lose. So I can't really do that, or I can't really afford to do that. So instead I mill him three. Seeing the creature swap makes me pretty happy that I had gone for this play as well, because that was another way he could have defeated us if we had double sacked for Titanial. He sets a back row. He special Cyber Dragon. I draw Gores, which is a totally dead card at this point. I'm just going to swing. If he has Mirror Force, well, I'm fucked. But if he doesn't have Mirror Force, then he loses his Cyber Dragon. He has D-Prison, so thankfully not Mirror Force. Kaius is going to attack over the Cyber Dragon. Main phase 2, I can summon the Thunder King. Now he's in the same position, but now he can't even special summon a Fortress. He can't even special summon a Cyber Dragon. He can't search for cards using gadgets. And the only thing that is going to beat me at this point is literally Mirror Force. And I'm just going to swing into any back row with both monsters. But thankfully for us, we top deck Mystical Space Typhoon. We're able to use it and come back from a crazy game. This was a game where we were super, super far behind. But thanks to Breaker being able to attack over the Dyna, thanks to Debris Dragon being optional, thanks to a couple of different things, top decking that third Kaius or having the high density of Kaius, we were able to play through what is essentially two brick hand versus a deck that has the nuts, which is Heavy Storm into Dyna Fortress. So pretty solid stuff from Vatos. Really, really close game. There was a lot of interesting decisions. I think the biggest mistake for me was not using the Debris Dragon to summon Ancient Fairy there. I think that definitely made this game a lot closer than it needed to be. All right, next game, next match. I move on to round two. I play against Kogram, aka Sinow. I lose the Rock, Paper, Scissors. One thing I like about Quick Draw is it's actually usually pretty good about going second. We do open up with double Kaius. We got that Dust Shoot. He opens up with Lila and phase mill three. He mills a Vayu, so he reveals what he's playing, basically. He's playing Lightsworn, Norlaris, Vayu Turbo. This deck is really scary. I kind of expect to see a lot of it tomorrow at RBET Rulers, just because this deck is so unbelievably ungodly good. It is just really, really good. I think people underrate how powerful Phantom of Chaos is in these types of decks. You'll see some stuff happen in this match that, like, the regular Vayu Turbo deck could never. Like, it is insane. So this hand, it's tricky, but I think because I know what I'm playing against, I have to foolish the Treeborn now. Once I get Treeborn and Grave, the Norlaris is kind of, it's kind of mitigated at least a little bit because we can keep bringing back Treeborn. It's not the best situation for us if he's able to go for Norlaris here, but we just got to do what we got to do. I set the Dandelion. I thought a really long time about doing this. I know his deck does play Eren, so it is tricky to set Dandelion here, but I think it's just I have to do it, right? And then I do go for Trap Dust Shoot here. I don't wait for him to Lila pop it. The reason being is because I just need to be able to take Eren if he has it naturally. And I also just need to be able to take Kaius if that's something he's playing, or I need to be able to take like something crazy before he has a chance to summon it. Plus, as a player of Kogram's caliber, he's going to know that I wouldn't set something not chainable into Lila. So he's not going to pop it. He's just going to attack me, or he's just going to make his play first. He knows that it's chainable. So he's not going to pop. He's just going to make his play first. So waiting here is actually like kind of a mistake. It's best to just Dust Shoot and take the monster now and then not give the opportunity for him to like make a weird play with like Lila pop or something. Unfortunately, I am punished. He does have Rota in hand, so I get punished for not waiting. It's possible it's better to wait just because of the existence of Rota and charge in the deck, but charge is in the graveyard. So I was thinking the only way he could have Eren, it's a 50-50, he has Eren or if he has Rota. And if he has Rota, he might want to go for something different than this. Anyway, we take the Elfin. Maybe that's a mistake. Maybe I should have left him with the Elfin. But if I leave him with the Elfin, he can have a crazy turn where he Rotas for Greffer. He pitch specials Elfin. He uses the Greffer to pitch the Vayu, send like another guy, and he could just have like a huge board turn two. Maybe I should have incentivized that because I have the tools to come back from a huge board and I wasn't going to die with Dandelion here. But then there's also a chance I leave him with Elfin and he Rotas for Aaron. So I'm just like, I don't know. Maybe I make him feel like I'm scared of the Greffer play, so he goes for the Greffer play instead of going for Aaron. It's a lot of mind games here. I'm not really sure exactly the right decision, but it was between Lila and Elfin. You never take the Vayu because he already has Vayu. So, like, you get what I'm saying. It's possible you take the Vayu. I'm not sure. He attacks a Dandy. He attacks a token. Here we are. Now, on our turn, we have a couple of plays. Treeborn can come back. And in hindsight, I make a really bad play. In hindsight, this play is terrible. I have enemy controller. And the reason enemy controller is good is because it's modal. I can use it to do things on my opponent's turn. So what I should have done this turn was just bring back Treeborn, go for my Lone Fire stuff. Go for Caius. Sacrifice Treeborn for Caius. Target a Lila. Run over the other Lila. Set the enemy controller. So this way, I have a piece of interaction. He's forced to play into the piece of interaction on his turn. Let's say he goes for Phantom. Let's say he goes for the Norlaris. I can cut him on his normal summon by going enemy controller, sack my token, take his guy, basically. But instead, I get like greedy about damage for some reason. But this damage doesn't matter as much as buying me a full extra turn, which is what enemy controller can do. So I steal his Lila with the intent of crashing. And then I go for this play, which is incredibly greedy because I'm getting this extra 500. I'm leaving the Lone Fire in attack position. Just very greedy play. I crash the Lilas. I attack for 3,300. And while this does represent lethal next turn, and I know his hand is pretty weak. Like if you look at his hand, it's got Rota Greffer lines, which are pretty strong. Like he can pitch Vayu, send Elfin, then he can synchro into the fucking Armor Master, run over the Lone Fire. And then if I clear the Armor Master, I'd have to use the Caius, but... basically, this is safe if he doesn't top deck the Dark Creator specifically. But if he top decks the Dark Creator specifically, I instantly lose the game. So I maybe should have played it a little bit more cautiously. I basically put him on top deck Dark Creator or bust. That being said, he could also top deck Norlaris here. Monster Reincarnation, pitch the Norlaris, add back Phantom of Chaos. There's a couple of different things he could top deck here that get him out of this situation. Whereas if I set the enemy controller, I think it would have been much harder for him to get out of the situation with a single top deck. Anyway, we pass the turn and he draws the Dark Creator. I want to pause and take a moment here for you guys to realize how fucking insane the Dark Creator is as a card. This card is probably one of the best cards in Edison format that doesn't have a major tournament win outside of the EU National Championship. The fact that this card only has one major tournament win is insane. This card is so unbelievably broken. It is like, this is a modern Yu-Gi-Oh card. This is a card that has seen play in like 2019. You know what I mean? Like this is a card that very much should not be legal in Edison format, or at the very least at three in Edison format. This card is very, very broken. But yeah, you'll see. Let's take a moment to see if you guys can figure out the lethal line. What are we Monster Reincarnation for here? What's the target? Well, clearly you have to get the fifth dark in the grave, right? So what's the fifth dark? Vayu. What are you targeting? Got to target Card Trooper, because Card Trooper can get you towards a dark that you can bring back with Dark Creator that can break the Titanial. So he's going to go Monster Reincarnation, pitch Vayu, add back Card Trooper, special summon the Dark Creator, normal summon Card Trooper first, mill three. Now, after you see these three mills, it should be pretty straightforward. He can go ahead and use the Dark Creator to bring back Dark Greffer, use the Rota to find another Dark, get Sirocco in the graveyard, stack his last card for Plague, synchro into Colossal Fighter with the Armed Wing, and then banish the Armed Wing and the Vayu, and he's dealing like fucking 14,000 damage this turn through two monsters, which is crazy. But yeah, the Dark Creator is so unbelievably broken. brings back the Dark Reffer. It did help him a lot that he had some very lucky mills this game, but this deck just plays a lot of good mills. You know, you have three Vayu, you have three Sirocco, you have Elfin, you have Plague, you have all of the Dark Monsters are good mills just because of the Dark Creator. So yeah, this is, it, even though I'm saying like he had some lucky mills, that's what his deck is designed to do. It's designed to have lucky mills and then set up this situation. Anyway, he activates Rota. He finds the line, basically, which is very impressive. A lot of people would mess this lethal up. He stacks for Plague. He banishes the Vayu and the Sirocco. He makes Armed Wing. He synchros into Colossal. He banishes the Vayu and the Armed Wing. He makes Armor Master. And yeah, this is super mega lethal. And we just lose because it's 200 or 100 there. Actually, it's not super mega lethal. It's exact lethal, which makes it even more frustrating. He deals however much there, 1,700 here, and then exactly 4,800. So, yeah. Sideboarding against this matchup, this is a tough matchup, but we have some strong game plans. So the strong game plan for this matchup is actually, he's going to board in Royal Oppression versus us. That's basically what I'm thinking. Or he's going to board in some sort of way to interact with Drill Warrior. Because Drill Dandy kind of fucks up the Norlaris strategy quite a bit. It makes it very difficult for them to ever get anything going. Even those big like OTK pushes have trouble happening through the tokens because Vayu negates Armed Wing's effect. So you don't have a lot of great ways to pierce. You basically need Dark Arm Dragon to be able to go for an OTK, or you need Royal Oppression to be able to like beat the Drill Dandy stuff. So my game plan is actually to side in the Dust Tornado, even though it seems weird, against the deck that has no back row game one. I am going to be siding in the Dust Tornado, because provided I get to Drill Dandy, I just win. So that's kind of my goal, is I get to Drill Dandy ASAP. I'm not going to side in the Breakers because I think that's just a little bit too much. At most, he's going to have like maybe Dust Shoot, Royal Oppression. Like he's not going to have 10 trap cards, but I am going to bring in the Dust Tornado as just an extra way to deal with Royal Oppression. I'm going to bring in, of course, Kaiku the Ghost Destroyer and DD Crow. Fantastic cards in this matchup. I'm going to bring in Vanity's Fiend. Vanity's Fiend's a little bit iffy because obviously it doesn't do anything to interact with Phantom of Chaos nor Laris, but you just kind of got to have it because if they do have those big turns where they're going for the Vayu play or they're going for the Dark Armed or the Dark Creator play, and they don't necessarily have the Phantom, or they have the Phantom, but their only good target is the Dark Creator, Vanity's Fiend does a great job there. So because it beats parts of the deck, I am still going to bring it in, and I am going to board in the Compulsory Evacuation Device as just a way to deal with not only the Vayu Synchros, but the what is that other card? Phantom of Chaos as well. It basically, they'll go priority target Norlaris, you'll chain Compulsory, it'll banish the Norlaris, I believe. And then, the Phantom of Chaos is sent back to their hand, and you beat the Norlaris Phantom of Chaos thing that way. Anyway, going into game two, you'll see how we sided. Anyway, we lost that game. That was an insane turn, by the way. Dark Creator should be banned, honestly. It's, like, the only other card in the game that's, like, kind of on par with, like, Chrystia's power level, I feel like. I feel like Chrystia is probably the best boss monster in the format, but it's, like, Chrystia, the Dark Creator when it resolves, and then Dark Arm Dragon. I think that it's, like, JD's in there somewhere too. I think those are clearly the best four, but the Dark Creator is like, I think definitely underrepresented in a lot of decks. Even in like the regular Vayu Turbo decks, they could play it. And it wouldn't be wrong, honestly. It wouldn't be wrong to play like one copy of that card because it's so ridiculously good. Lone Fire is going to activate. We are just going to get Dandelion here. Because once again, my game plan now is just get Drill Dandy. That's it. If I get Drill Dandy, I win. I'm going to get Dandelion in attack position. Now I have access to Dandelion. Either he attacks over it, I get the tokens. He attacks over it and clears the tokens. I can debris back, and then I can set up Drill. So no matter what, I can set up Drill this game. I've got Dust Tornado. As long as he doesn't like literally Norlaris me this turn, and even if he does, I have Dandelion in play, so I'll be able to get the tokens. He goes Summon Lila, and this just kind of proves my point about the last game. He attacks first, showing that he like doesn't give a shit about back row. He's going to run over the Dandy. We are going to get our two tokens. We are going to take some damage, which it's important. It's important that we took damage here. It's actually a bad thing for us. A very bad thing. He's going to go ahead and pop the back row. If you see his hand, though, he could have maybe dug deeper to try and find Eren if we had summoned it in defense position. So I still stand by my play, but taking that 1,400 damage is, it's a liability to say the least. Envase, he mills double Vayu, which is bullshit, but again, the deck is designed to mill really well. Like, it just has so many cards that you can mill that are good cards. So, on average, like, if you're milling three cards, you're going to hit one good card in this deck just based off statistics. So, him hitting two, while I can complain about it all day, it's just, that's just what the deck is designed to do. It's not like he only has two good things to mill in his deck, which, again, We'll get into that later. I draw Lonefire, which is amazing because it means I can hit for a bajillion damage this turn. I'm going to go quick draw, pitch hamster, synchro into drill, attack over the Lila, and say basically you have to deal with this next turn or you lose. And I'm going to pitch the Raikou to banish the drill. If he doesn't deal with these two cards and beat me this turn, he loses next turn. We will be able to find game using some combination of Debris Dragon or Drill Warrior or Quick Draw or whatever next turn if he doesn't deal with our board. So he's got Greffer. He's got Pitch Elfin, Send Plague, Foolish Burial, Send Sirocco. And I'm just like, bro, am I actually going to get OTK'd through Lonefire Titanial two games in a row? Let's see if we can find the line for him. If he goes Vayu, Banish Elfin, right? Special Summon Armor Master. If he goes Vayu, Banish Sirocco, Special Summon Armed Wing, Stack for Plague, Synchro into Colossal Fighter. There's no Warriors in the graveyard. So he can crash with Titanial, bring back the Colossal Fighter, run over the Lonefire for 23, dropping us to 43. Dark Greffer attacks directly for 17, and Armor Master attacks directly for 25, dropping us down to 100 life points. If he has another way to summon a monster, let's take a look at his hand real quick. He has Sky Scourge and Heavy Storm. If he has another way to summon a monster here, then he could have potentially been able to go for that extra 100 damage. I'm trying to think if there's a way he could have got that extra 100 damage in a different way. Because, like, he still has to go for the Colossal, right? And he still has to make the Armor Master and the Dark Greffer. Where is he getting that extra 100 damage from? Is it possible he should have saw through all of this and gone for the Allure first to banish the Sky Scourge to try and dig towards the Dark Creator? Maybe. But then, if he finds the Dark Creator, he can't summon it because he's going to have to summon Greffer to get towards 5 Darks in the Grave. So I'm not really sure. I'm not really sure if there was a different line here for him, but the fact of the matter is he's gonna go for that play. I also don't know his extra deck. There could have maybe been a red dragon in his extra. I'm not really sure. If there's red dragon in his extra deck, then I think he clears. I'm not really sure. Either way, he has to use both his values to set this up, set this situation up, and then attack, 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 attack. Put us to 100. And we are now down 4 cards. We're down to 100 life points. But, like I said in the sideboarding, if he didn't out my board and beat me literally this turn, or in the last turn, and also in the sideboarding, I have Drill Dandy. And Drill Dandy does beat these boards. And as you can see for us, we actually have a line as well with just what we've been given. Well, actually, let's get to the draw phase. With just what we have here, we have a line to win the game this turn. So Drill's going to come back. We're going to add back Quick Draw Synchron. I'm going to Normal Debris. Blow up the field. This does lose to DD Crow, but I figured if he had all that shit and DD Crow, then he deserves this one because he had the fucking nuts. Alas, he does not. So we're going to blow up the field, pitch special, and make the Nitro Warrior for 2800 exact lethal. Incredibly close game. He was just 100 points shy there. I'm really curious if there was a different line. I'm really, really curious because there was a lot of ways he could have done this. There was like, he could have pitched the Norlaris. He had an extra resource. He had an extra Allure of Darkness. You know what I mean? Like, he could have, I don't know. He could have maybe done something a little bit differently. I'm not sure if it would have ended up in him winning the game, but he could have pushed a little bit further this game. If you guys see a line in this game, let me know in the comments below. If you guys see a way that he could have won this game too, I'm really interested because that was a crazy hand. It was like just an absolutely crazy position. A lot of interesting like cards coming together. But game three, we are going second. And game three, we have kind of a tough hand. We do have Card Trooper. We do have Foolish Burial to get the Treeborn. But having Avarice early is not great. Vanny's Fiend, obviously not going to do anything unless we have a tribute for it. He's going to draw and pass. And I'm like, okay, I can stop Gores later. I'm not going to play into it this turn. I'm just going to Card Trooper activate set Torrential Pass after I Foolish Treeborn. I'll basically Torrential any normal summon he goes for just so I can get the Card Trooper draw, bring back the Treeborn, and be able to summon Vanities. He draws for turn. He summons Aaron. I'm going to Torrential that every day of the week. I don't want him milling, setting up for his Dark Creator, setting up for his Phantoms, whatever. And now my Treeborn is live, and I can go Treeborn Vanities and hit him for 2,400. So I like my position here. I can set the bottomless. Most of the things that out Vanity Fiend don't get hit by bottomless, though, I think it's like Gale, and he'd have to go like, I don't know, Allure Burial, or he'd have to go like Grefg Activate, then next turn Phantom copy whatever he sent with the Grefg. But I don't know if it's right to set bottomless here, but I do, basically, is what I'm saying. Just because I'm like, okay, there's maybe some bullshit I'll want to bottomless this turn. He does have an out to Vanity's Fiend in Lightning Vortex. So he has a discard outlet. He's able to put Norlaris in the graveyard, which is terrifying because of his discard outlet. He's got Foolish. So he would have had Foolish. He could have had Foolish Phantom as well as a way to out this board situation. But if he has that, like, he's blowing up the field through bottomless. Like, it's not like, you know what I mean? Like, he's not like, you get what I'm saying. He goes for Monster Reincarnation, targets the Phantom, and this plays through bottomless. And he's able to get Plague in the graveyard. And then on top of being able to set up the Norlaris through Vanity's Fiend while clearing the Vanity's Fiend and finding Phantom of Chaos, he's also able to do this through bottomless and Vanity's, basically. He also has fucking Vayu Elfin in hand. Like, literally best case scenario for him. Like, what the fuck? And he's able to solidify a Plague in the graveyard as well. So I'm just like absolutely fucked this game. Thankfully, though, we did have that Foolish to lay that Treeborn, so we can at least wall out the Armor Master a little bit longer. He's able to bring out the Armor Master, hit us for 25. This is incredibly quick clock. If he has another normal summon, I have like maybe two turns to find something. I draw Trap Dust Shoot, which is one of my... I fucking hate this card for a lot of reasons. You have to leave it in this matchup. You basically just have to leave it in this matchup, because if you have it early, it can give you a free win. But if you draw it after you get Norlaris, it is absolutely the worst card in your deck. He has a back row on top of him going for this, which is really frustrating, but at the same time, I'm just happy it's not an additional monster. We're able to bring out the Treeborn to wall up. Never set the Dust Shoot here. I'm going to need to use the Treeborn multiple times. He attacks the Treeborn. He passes a turn. We draw Kaiku the Ghost Destroyer. And like, okay, that can maybe do something, but it's not doing anything right now. I'm going to bring back the Treeborn, pass the turn. He goes for Rota. He finds Armageddon Knight. And I am so fucking grateful he plays this conservatively. He goes Armageddon Knight, send Vayu. What he should have done here was stack for Plague, make Goyo, steal my Treeborn, and then attack me for 25. And I'm probably never coming back from that. Outside of specifically Debris Dragon, Target Card Trooper, make Black Rose. But if you see the situation right now, like, he has this card, which was an insane top deck off of fucking, what is that card? What is that? Off of Norlaris. He top decked fucking Treacherous after going for the nuke and having Vayu Elfin. He top decked literally like Quick Play Regeki. So he's just drawing the nuts here. But if he had just stacked for Plague, made Goyo, and then attacked over Treeborn Frog and stolen it, I 100% am losing this game. As it stands, he just is really passive with it. He attacks me for 25. He leaves the Armageddon in play, passes a turn back. We draw into Compulsory Evacuation Device. God bless this card. It is so fucking incredibly good. I cannot believe that I haven't been playing this card in Quick Draw up until this point. It is so useful in these types of matchups. I'm going to summon Kaiku, attack the Armageddon Knight. This does force his Treacherous Trap Hole. So I'm getting a 1-for-1 Treacherous Trap Hole, but you know what? That's okay. I'm going to set my Compulsory Bluff Mirror Force. Now, all he has to do here is summon another monster, basically. And I'm pretty cooked, but no matter what, Compulsory will clear the Armor Master, and I'll be able to survive the turn through just about anything as long as he doesn't have another summon plus stack for Plague. So because his hand is two bricks here, he goes stack for Plague to try and make Bryonic to play around Mirror Force. And this is not a bad play because our Torrential is gone. I actually think that this is the correct play, but he's going to stack for Plague. Stacks the dead cards. He's for sure drawing a dead card next turn. Synchros into Bryonic. Pitches for Bryonic. Hits the Compulsory. Compulsory's going to chain. Hit the Armor Master. We're going to take 2300. But on our turn, as long as we draw something we can play, literally something we can play, Treeborn plus the something we can play keeps us alive. So, insane top decks. Back to back. I top deck Compulsory into Avarice. Really, really lucky stuff. I'm able to bring out the Treeborn Frog. So, his insane luck hand with the double Vayu mill, with the last game, with the fucking, this time having the Norlaris into the Elfin plus Vayu plus Treacherous Trap Hole off the top for Norlaris, like, his insane nut draw is kind of getting balanced out by our final, like, luck here with the Pot of Avarice. I activate Pot of Avarice. I'm able to shuffle back basically five cards that are good here. I made a mistake. I think I probably should have shuffled back maybe Cyber Dragon or maybe Kaiku the Ghost Destroyer instead of Card Trooper to make sure Debris Dragon off the top was live. But it's a minor mistake. I think I definitely should have shuffled back the Kaiku though. It also prevents like some other things if I have it. I'm going to set the Raikou and I'm going to pass. He's going to activate Bryonic, targeting the Raikou, which to me is, it's not a huge mistake, but there's definitely consideration to targeting the Treeborn and then like not, and then like attacking maybe. I don't know. I don't know if that's correct play, but just pitching here to target the Raikou is also probably not the correct play because I can just reset it next turn. And then you just went minus one for no reason. So I think it's like, you're kind of hoping to draw, I'm not even really sure what next turn. Like you're bleeding cards to try and draw into maybe another Armageddon Knight. I think that's the only thing that really gets him out of this situation with the Plague gone. So yeah, I don't know if I like pitching the Solar Recharge there. I think that like just taking the Raikou trade is fine. Here I do obviously get punished by drawing the Debris Dragon. I'm like, well, fuck me. I have to set the Raikou again. I can't afford to set the Solemn. But that's okay because like even if he has, it's only specifically Armageddon Knight here that does anything. If he summons anything but Armageddon Knight, then he still can't pitch to Bryonic. So he can't like pitch and summon at the same time. And he can't get through two monsters. And if he attacks into my Raikou ever, basically he's under the Abyss till he finds Armageddon Knight. And I'm under the Abyss until I find a second play I can commit to the board that doesn't get rid of my Treeborn Frog. Whether that's a Quick Draw or a Caius or whatever, you know what I mean? He decides to summon the Greffer and finally say, fuck it, we're going to press. Raikou's going to pop the Bryonic. Obviously, it's the bigger monster. And we're going to mill three cards. On our turn, we draw into Lightning Vortex, but now I've pretty much solidified it. I can go Debris. Well, first thing first, I can bring out Treeborn. It's important that we make Black Rose Dragon here because Black Rose Dragon is the fastest clock. A, it stops him from like setting monsters to buy time. B, C, if we make Iron Chain, we risk milling him into his fifth dark for Dark Creator off the top, or we risk milling him into like further Elfins or Sirocco's or whatever the fuck. Like Grave Resource, Necrogarna, that sort of thing. So Treeborn Frog, honestly, going for Foolish and Treeborn Frog in this matchup makes this matchup so much better. Look how much value I got out of this card. I got like this one Treeborn Frog that I Foolished on the first turn of the game bought me like 5,000 life points. It bought me like both Solar Recharges. It bought me my opponent's Bryonic. It bought me the position for like six turns in a row. And then it's also buying me like a much safer path to victory than making Iron Chain. So we go for Black Rose, we attack over the Dark Greffer, we set Solemn Judgment. Don't set the other two cards because obviously you want Trap Dust Shoot in hand to pitch the Lightning Vortex. He passes a turn, we draw Card Trooper. Now if his hand is anything at all, this should win. Because we mill three, we attack for 19. Even if he has Gores here, main phase two, we just Vortex the Gores. We have Solemn for any card he draws, and that's checkmate. And we managed to win both game two and game three with under 800 life points, which is crazy. Absolutely insane match. Like so much crazy shit happened this match. It just goes to show the power of Treeborn Frog in this deck and how it improves your Foolish Burial in specifically these types of matchups. These matchups where they may have deck dev, these matchups where they may have Royal Oppression, these matchups where you just need a guy. You know what I mean? You just need a dude. And I think having access to that for your Foolish Burial is super, super, super fucking important in Quick Draw deck. I don't think I could play the Quick Draw deck without Treeborn Frog moving forward, simply just because it's just so important in like these fringe matchups and these Royal Oppression matchups and these Vayu matchups that weren't popular in 2010 that are super popular now. You do need that like repeatable guy, and I think that, yeah, obviously this game is like proof of it. Moving on to the finals, I am playing against Derek, who is an RBET ruler qualified player. He top aided RBET Fullerton with hybrid Black Wings. He's a really powerful player. I grew up playing with Derek. He's really, really strong. So he's part of my play group. And I know he's like good. I know he definitely, whatever he's playing is going to be a legit like serious deck. So I'm like, all right, I made it to the finals through the crazy match. What could I possibly have to face in this? He goes set one Gold Sark for future fusion, pass the turn. So when you see this, there's three things really, probably more like two. Gold Sark for future fusion set monster is, I have a White Stone of Legend that I want to set and get Blue Eyes to get trade in. I have a Mask Dragon which I want to set in order to wall up till I can get my future fusion. I have a totem dragon. I have a snowman eater or a Sangin in Diva Hero, because Diva Hero is the other deck that plays Goldsark and Future Fusion. So in all of those instances, let's just say all of those instances basically, it's pretty bad to go Lone Fire into Titanial here. Like, it just doesn't really get me where I want to go. In all of those instances, it kind of locks up my gores. It kind of makes my hand a little bit stickier. And almost always, it is better to get the Titanial out of the deck before setting a Miller like Raikou. Almost always. But I'm thinking there's a good chance that that's the Snowman Eater. I also know Derek in person. I know he doesn't really play dragons like that. So I'm almost 99% certain it's Diva Hero. So I'm thinking the cards that are set here are Sangin or Snowman Eater. If I go Lone Fire into Titanial, attack over Sangin, it just lets him search Diva, which is an out to Titanial. Yes, I do have compulsory to out the I have compulsory to out the catastrophe that he could make, but he didn't set any back row. So because he didn't set any back row, it's telling me, and also because he searched for Future Fusion, it's telling me he has probably Heavy Storm. If he doesn't have Heavy Storm, then it doesn't make a lot of sense to search for Future Fusion, if that makes sense. So basically what I'm thinking is going Lone Fire, attack over Sangin is a one-way ticket to me just losing my Titanial for no value, basically just being in a bad spot if it is Sangin. If it's Snowman Eater, then I trade one for one with my Titanial, but in that instance, it's much better for me to have set the Raikou, because I'd rather trade the Raikou with the Snowman Eater and have the Titanial for later and potentially mill a Dandelion, so my Titanial is even better, as opposed to just the alternative, which is like just one for one trading with the defense position monster and basically sacrificing my position for nothing. I set the Raikou. He goes Rota off the top for Stratos Search, confirming that he is playing Diva Hero, or at least some type of hero deck that plays Stratos and Ocean. He's going to attack the set monster. I'm going to try to trade my Raikou with the set monster. We're going to see if it's Sangin. I figured if it was Sangin, he would have flipped it. So I'm pretty sure it's Snowman Eater at this point, and my suspicions are confirmed. And we do mill and hit Treeborn Frog. Once again, the fucking MVP. Literally such a good card in this deck. I'll show you guys why in a second. He sets a back row passes. Standby phase, I bring out Treeborn Frog. Main phase one, I go Heavy Storm. And the Treeborn Frog is forcing a Phoenix Wing Windblast, which is pretty good. That being said, if the Treeborn wasn't in play, like, maybe he doesn't activate this. Or he can't activate this because I just don't have a legal target. You can't Phoenix Wing an activated Heavy Storm for whatever reason. It's just a Yu-Gi-Oh! Ruling. So maybe it's better or worse or something, but it's giving me more information because I get to see him discard a card from his hand, basically. So he discards Elemental Hero Ocean here. I basically get a free Ocean for my Treeborn Frog, which is a pretty good trade. I'm not gonna lie. My hand doesn't really deal with Ocean set back row very well, so pretty solid trade. And we are able to shuffle away that Treeborn because I did save the life, the Lone Fire. So honestly, pretty good. Honestly, pretty good situation. I have an uncontested Titanial. If he has Miracle Fusion, it is only trading with my Titanial, so I'm pretty okay with that. If he does have his Diva, then he has his Diva. I was thinking of setting Compulsory and Mystical Space Typhoon, but then I thought back to the first turn and I was like, wait, the way he's playing, it signified Heavy Storm. Even though he did set Windblast last turn, it is kind of, it's giving Heavy Storm vibes. So I'm going to keep the Compulsory in hand. Worst case scenario, he does have that Diva and he's able to defeat my Titanial. But at the very least, you know, like, what can I do about that? He goes summon Diva, and I'm like, okay, well, fuck me. You know, at least I have the compulsory that can answer it later as well. I am going to lose my Titanial for nothing, for no reason, but at least it got to run over the Stratos for free, so it got me some plus, you know, it got me some sort of value. He's going to activate Future Fusion. We do have the Typhoon. He ended up not having the Heavy Storm, so a little bit silly that we didn't set both, but I think better safe than sorry in this type of circumstance. And it's also not that bad of a situation for us to be in because, like, you know, he has ally, but we have Gorse, Caius, compulsory. Like, it doesn't really matter. And we have a lot of play still this game. Plus, we get a top deck. We find Brain Control, making my hand even more insane. I'm just going to set the compulsory pass. If he summons further, I can compulsory the Catastrophe and then drop Gorse. He's going to attack for 22. I'm just going to compulsory it. I want him to commit more here. Main phase two, he summons Armageddon. He sends Malicious. He passes. So he doesn't send Plague here, which is interesting. If I was him, I probably would have sent Plague, but who knows? We draw Avarice, which is the nuts, obviously. So we just play it. Fuck it. If you draw Lone Fire in this deck, I think this deck goes from like A tier to like S plus tier. If you draw Lone Fire and don't draw Titanial. When you have Lone Fire, it's just like, this is like an S tier deck. Because everything in your deck is just facilitated. Debris Dragon's facilitated. Quick Draw's facilitated. Fucking Avarice is facilitated. Like literally all of your busted cards get facilitated the second you find Lone Fire. So the hands where you draw it, it's much better. We normal Card Trooper. Very solid normal here. This is definitely the play because if he has Caius, he'll be forced to spend his Malicious to sack for Caius to target the Card Trooper. We're going to attack over the Armageddon Knight and pass the turn. He's actually going to special Evil Guy Prodigy and go for Caius. But either way, I'm very happy with this. My Card Trooper cleared an Armageddon Knight, so plus one there. It traded with an Evil Guy Prodigy, so another plus one there. It does get banished, but now this Caius is going to attack me directly, which turns on, guess what, motherfucking Gores. So he attacks me for 24. I'm going to drop the Gores, and now I'm representing Lethal with Brain Control. This turn, I'm curious if he had top decked the Trag, but maybe he had, maybe he hadn't. I'm not really sure. This turn, we are going to Brain Control and try to go for game. We're going to switch all our cards to attack position, hit for 24, hit for 24. He does have the Trag. We are actually going to attack and run it over. I know you guys are thinking, like, why not sack it for Caius and banish the Trigodia? Big issue there is he still has Malicious and Grave. So he didn't send Plague, which makes me a little bit nervous. He has Plague in hand. And if I go sack for Caius and he goes, okay, banishes the Trigodia, it drops to 1,000. He can make Colossal Fighter on his turn. And we don't have a great immediate out to Colossal Fighter. Technically, Hamster can get us there, but we don't have a great immediate out to it. So what I'm going to do actually instead is save my Caius and attack over the Trigodia, set my Dust Tornado and set my Hamster and just give him his Caius back. Like the most this Caius is doing here is trading with the token. We have Dust Tornado to clear any potential back row. Hamster will guarantee we have a body at the very least. If he does make Colossal Fighter, then the Ryko can pop that. The Caius can banish whatever's left over and we'll be fine. He attacks the set monster for information and he concedes. So yeah, basically I think this is the best play. We can't really super get punished by this outside of specifically D.Va, I think. Yeah, I think it's just D.Va. And even D.Va, he would have to do some weird fucking shit where he goes like D.Va, summon the other D.Va in attack position, Synchro into Stardust, attack over the Hamster, attack the Malicious into the set Ryko, negate the Ryko with Stardust, and then main phase 2, make Colossal. And even that, like, is fine. You know what I mean? It's totally chill. Because I have Gores left over, which can run over the Stardust. I have Caius to banish the Colossal, because I'll still have the token body left over. And I'll be fine. So I think even in this circumstance, the biggest punish for us, it still makes us fine. So yeah, we're actually just fine. What I would have done if I was him was not attacking the Gores, basically. So siding in this matchup is a little bit tricky going second, because going first, you have a lot of good cards going first. But going second, some of those cards they're not so good. Thunder King, much worse going second. Pulling the Rug, much worse going second. I mean, you still bring them in, but they're much worse going second. I do bring in my Vanity's Fiend, and this is a matchup where I do side out double Thessalos, or I might side out one Thessalos, one Caius for double Vanities, because you just don't want to have too many tribute monsters going second, and you don't want to have too many normal summons, and then just be set off by like a Wind Blast or a Stratos Wind Blast start. I don't know if I brought in the Breakers, but I definitely considered it. I'm not sure if I brought them in or not. I'm also not sure if I brought in the Dust Tornado, but going second, moving forward, what I'm going to be doing a lot more of is actually bringing in the Dust Tornado because of the potency of that turn one fucking Wind Blast shit. It's really annoying. Or maybe even just bringing in Breakers to force it. I'm not really sure. Maybe Cyber Dragon's the best way to do that. Let's say you go Stratos Wind Blast. Yeah, Cyber Dragon's kind of the best force. Yeah, we bring in Kaiku, we bring in DD Crow. They are repeatable ways to attack his graveyard plays. We do bring in the Compulsory as a way to attack his Synchros, and we definitely bring in the Vanity's Fiends. But I was thinking in the future I might try and bring in Cyber Dragons going second in this matchup. Yeah, I don't know. Moving into the game. Let's just go into the game. You guys will see. You definitely bring in Pulling the Rug because it stops Caius, D.Va, and Stratos. He wrote us for Stratos. He searches. I think bringing in Breaker is not the worst either just because it outs Dyna, which their deck definitely sides. And then unfortunately for us, he has set back row. So, like, normally the play here, it's, like, pretty slam dunk, brain control, sack for vanities. But if it's Windblast, we immediately lose. That being said, I probably should have just done it because sitting here and just bleeding 1,800 is, like, stupid. But I decided to set compulsory as a way to maybe mitigate the potential Windblast. I don't know. I wanted to bait the Windblast first and then maybe stick vanities after that. He attacks me for 1,800. He doesn't commit any further into Torrential or Mirror Force. He just passes a turn. We draw Kaiku the Ghost Destroyer, and I'm like, fuck it, we ball. Let's just Brain Control. Let's force the Windblast now if he has it. And I decide to sack for Caius to target his back row. Not sure if I should have done this or done the Vanity's Fiend. It's hard to say. This one was tough. We do hit his Pro Heavy Storm, pass the turn, and now we're actually in a decent spot. We have compulsory to deal with the synchro play. His Heavy Storm is gone. We have DD Crow to stop Miracle. We have potential to start sticking vanities, that sort of stuff. He normals Ocean, but then he sets three more back row, and I'm like, oh, fuck. So, kind of in a tough spot. I go ahead and just attack to see what he's about. He does have Phoenix Wing discarding Malicious, which is not ideal for your boy. Not ideal for your boy, because it means he will be able to activate this Ocean targeting the Stratos, causing us all sorts of trouble. I have a couple of options, but I'm not sure they're great. The first option is I spend the compulsory on the Ocean, bounce it. He doesn't get the Stratos in his draw phase, obviously, or I could do it now. It doesn't fucking matter when I do it, but, he won't get access to the Stratos, or I could let him activate the Ocean, Chain Crow banishing the Stratos, but then he has the Malicious resource, which is really frustrating because I don't know. I didn't want to play into Bottomless. I wanted to try and get my tokens going so I could at least try and stick a Vanities maybe, but it's just unrealistic. He's going to target the Stratos. We're going to ditch the DD Crow. He gets the DD Crow out of our hand for free, basically, because he committed nothing to doing that. And yeah, he attacks over the Dandy. We do get two tokens here, and he is going to Future Fusion main phase 2, which is incredibly deadly. We do have Caius off the top. We do have ways to try and clear this Elemental Hero Ocean before it gets yet another plus on us, but he does have Solemn Judgment, and he's able to Solemn the Caius, and it's just really hard for us to come back when every single play we make is getting stuffed and we have tribute monsters or too many tribute monsters going second. This is particularly why I cannot stress the importance of siding out tribute monsters when you're going second versus decks that are going to be bringing in a shitload of back row versus you, like this deck, for example. Yeah, he activates the Ocean, adds back the Evil Guy, and we're just drowning in card disadvantage at this point. There's really nothing we can do. We have no tribute fodder. I can summon Kaiku to try and run over the Ocean and banish his Malicious and stuff, but he has another Windblast, and we've been set back two draw phases. We have nothing but normal summons in our hand. This game's just over. He can summon the Absolute Zero, and I figured we might as well play it a little bit further to see more if he wants to commit more cards. He already knows I'm playing compulsory because I played it last game, and he's not going to get any more information out of me besides his compulsory, so I think it's fine to just keep going to see if he has anything beyond this. I'm going to compulsory the Absolute Zero. He's going to set another back row and pass a turn. So right now what I know is I've seen double Windblast, I've seen Treeborn still in, I've seen Malicious still in, I see Sangin still in, so that's good to know about. I'm going to summon the Kaiku the Ghost Destroyer, he's going to bottomless, and at this point there's no reason for me to do anything else because he can beat me with what's in play. So I'm just going to concede, save time, go to the next game. Game 3, obviously things get a lot better. We have Thunder King, we have Pulling the Rug. And I open up a weird hand, but a nut hand I have never opened up before. Like a type of nut hand with this deck I've never opened up. It's just Card Trooper 4 back row with a Solemn. And the Card Trooper mills insane God mills here. I milled double Dandy. I have never milled double Dandy in my life. But after seeing this and having Caius in hand, I was like, I can't lose this game. Like, that's insane. Like, I have the nuts back row. Even if I do end up having to Torrential at some point, it's like, I'm getting a card draw off of it too. It's like, it's just so good. Like, this position is incredible. He just passes a turn back. I can safely play into Trag Gores. I'm just going to mill 3, attack for 19. He's going to drop Trigodia. I'm going to sack for Caius. Banish the Trigodia, deal 1,000. And yeah, his situation is really bad here. Now, later in the game, we are going to see if he that he does draw Gores, but he didn't have it here. So because he didn't have it here and he didn't drop Gores here on that effect damage of Caius dealing him 1,000, I have a read that he doesn't have Gores. He top decks Returnee, special Cyber Dragon. I'm going to compulsory my own Card Trooper as a way to sort of put him in a bad position. It's like basically convert this Cyber Dragon now or lose your Cyber Dragon for free because I can set my Card Trooper and I can contact Fuse with your Cyber Dragon into Chimera Tech. So it's either lose your Cyber Dragon for free or trade it with a compulsory functionally or convert it now. He sacrifices it for Caius and I have pulling the rug for the Caius. So feeling pretty strongly about the pulling the rug sideboard inclusion. He passes the turn back. Here, I attack for 24. I play it even incredibly safe around the top deck Gores because I'm like, okay, how do I lose here? Top deck Gores. That's how I lose. So I'm going to attack for 2,400 and then either set the Ryko or summon the Thunder King. If he doesn't have Gores, I'm going to summon Thunder King. If he does have Gores, I'm going to set the Ryko. I attack for 24 and he did top deck Gores. So sometimes it's better safe than sorry. Play around the top deck Gores. Even though I knew he didn't have it last turn, maybe there's possibly a chance he had it and didn't want to drop it on the effect damage to bait me into this attack. There's like a whole bunch of mind games here with the Gores. So I figured better safe than sorry. Main phase 2, I can always summon the Thunder King if he doesn't have it and just be in a great spot. I'm going to set the Ryko now, and at the very least, I can sort of stabilize this board. If he summons further, I can go for Tarantula, so we're kind of chilling. He goes switch, switch. He attacks with the Gores over the Caius. He attacks into the Ryko. I'm going to flip and pop the Gores and mill 3 cards. We do mill some cards that would have been pretty strong to draw here. Compulsory, Debris, and Vanities all would have been great, but at the same time, you know, whatever. That's just how milling works. He sets a monster, passes. I draw Sangin. I'm like, based. I'm going to set the Sangin and pass. He draws for turn. So if I'm him right now, I probably don't want to attack the sets. I want to start clearing these tokens because the tokens are like, they will eat time from him. And in order to come back into this game, he needs to start like clearing the cards that don't. Like, attacking over a token is a solid plus. It's maybe not a plus one, but it's definitely a plus. Whereas if you attack into a set monster, you risk it kind of being a one for one if it's like a Ryko or if it's like a Snowman Eater or something like that. If it's like a Sangin or whatever, you risk it being a one for one, a hamster, for example. You risk it being bad for you attacking into the set monster. Whereas if you attack a token, you're just pretty much guaranteedly getting value that way. Whether or not you want to call a token a plus plus, I think he should have been attacking the tokens. Instead, he attacks the set monster, which I think is the biggest mistake this entire match. Definitely shouldn't have attacked the set here because the Sangin gets me the search for the quick draw. And once I have quick draw plus Solemn, I mean, he's at 27, I have quick draw Solemn, the game's over. Like, there's nothing he can play from this point that's winning him this game. He goes main phase 2, set a monster, but that just doesn't matter. I can pitch special quick draw, keep the token wall going, synchro into Drill Warrior, attack for 12, pitch, banish. I have a wall, he's at 15, he's dead next turn, I have Caius in the grave. And I have Solemn. And there's just nothing. There's nothing. I have Torrential Solemn. Like, there's nothing he can do. He can't deal 7,700 through two tokens, Card Trooper, Torrential Solemn. And then on top of that, stop the drill plus Caius Lethal that's coming next turn. So, yeah. He flips Treeborn. He sacks it for Mally. He flips Snowman Eater. He pops his own Mally. Like, this is a cool play. Now, he does know my set monster's Card Trooper, or he should know it, because I compulsoried it earlier, and he hasn't seen me discard it. So he should know what my set monster is here. He special summons Darkrai Dragon. He priority targets the set monster. Another instance in which he probably should have priority targeted a token. It's irrelevant. I am going to chain my Torrential Tribute here. He's already normal summoned. He's already spent his Darkrai Dragon, which, by the way, he was kind of telling me he had earlier in the match because he was checking his graveyard too much. I think if you have Darkrai Dragon in hand and you're on playing on Dueling Book, one thing you should be doing is not checking your graveyard. That's it. It's just like pretty much just don't check your graveyard, basically. Like, try to memorize how many darks are in your grave. Try to keep track of it, because if you have Darkrai Dragon and you're checking your grave a bunch, like, your opponent's going to try and play around it as much as they can. So, yeah. He's going to special Darkrai. He's going to priority pop the set. He should know that that is a Card Trooper, though. What he should have done was taken a 50-50 on the back row, or he should have targeted one of the tokens. Either way, we are going to clear all the monsters, draw Foolish. He's going to Miracle into Absolute Zero. No reason for me to stop this. I have game next turn through Absolute Zero, and that's only 2,500 damage. So I let this resolve. I bring out Caius, or I draw Caius. Didn't matter if I drew Caius, I had one in my grave. I'm going to be able to bring out the Drill Warrior, have it, attack directly, sack for Caius, and then target itself and win the match. So, crazy stuff. One thing about this match that was really, really interesting was, I think, just milling double dandy. That was nice. I've never had that sort of, like, nut mill before, but it felt really good. Another thing that I really like about this list is the Treeborn Frog. One thing I'm not super duper happy with is the amount of tribute monsters and the difficulty I have being kind of like stuffed post board with like normal summon. Like if my opponent has Dyna plus back row, that is a little bit annoying, but I do have the breakers for it. I'm not sure if I want this many monsters in my sideboard, basically. I think what I might do is I might actually cut a Vanity's Fiend. I might actually cut the Lightning Vortex. I might keep the Lightning Vortex. I don't know. And I might cut the Thunder King. I'm definitely keeping the Triple Breaker. I've been very happy with it. Definitely keeping the Double Cyber, the Kaiku, and the Crow. But I think I might want some more, like, spell cards or quick play spell cards like Book of Moon or trap cards in my sideboard. I'm not really sure. That's, like, my biggest takeaway from this as of right now. Because this last game, being able to set four and summon a guy was, like, it felt broken. I'm not going to lie. It felt pretty broken. This deck is unironically kind of decent when it has a bunch of actionable trap cards. So, yeah, I don't know. Food for thought. Really incredible 8-man. I'm super excited for RBET Rulers. I'll see you guys in the tailgate stream in a couple of hours if you're just tuning into this. This was one of the most fun 8-mans I've ever played. And it just kind of goes to solidify that Quick Draw is one of the most fun decks. Because even the games where I was losing, they were like pretty interesting games where there was a lot of decision points. And like I had play in every game. Even the games where I was like kind of behind, I had play and I was able to pull back ahead. And the games where I was like you never really get shut out with this deck, which is something I really like about it. It just feels like you always have chances. You always have game. And you always have different ways to like permute your deck with the sideboarding to make it approach your opponent's like configuration like slightly differently. So cool deck. Definitely play it. If it's your first like time playing Edison, I would say this is a great deck to pick up just because it's super fun and it teaches you everything you need to know about the format. I'll see you guys in the stream later, and I'll see you guys for RBET Rulers tomorrow. Peace.